Good evening, everyone. I welcome you all for this exciting session on conduction system pacing workshop. Today, we have a 27 years old female who was presented to us with recurrent episodes of presynco. So on evaluation, she was diagnosed to have a complete heart block with an RAQ-RS escape rhythm. They have worked up for the etiology of the complete heart block. Of course, being a 27 years old lady, the congenital CHB is going to be the most common etiology. They have ruled out other possible causes. Cardiac MRI done showed no evidence of scar anywhere in the heart. Echo ruled out any structural heart disease. So obviously, it was a straightforward decision for us to go ahead with pacing. The crux here is being a 27 years old female, she's going to require pacing for the rest of her life. So long-term RV pacing, we know the detrimental effects of RV pacing. At least in 2 to 5% of the patient, there is a high chance that they can develop a pacing-induced cardiomyopathy during follow-up. So getting a conduction system pacing in these people would be of great help, as both the ventricles will be activated in a synchronized way, both electrically as well as mechanically. So the options were discussed and they have agreed for conduction system pacing. So these are lab setups, so you can focus the EP system also, just a glimpse. So we usually do the procedure with the EP lab. We have the EP lab in our hospital. The big advantage of having the EP system is simultaneous recording of both intracardiac electrograms as well as 12-lead ECG. So that's going to give a good advantage for the implanter. You'll be able to see your intracardiac electrograms right in front of your eye, and you'll be able to observe what the ECG changes are occurring while doing the procedure. So it's our practice still to put two catheters from the groin. So one quadripolar catheter will be in the hispanal region, and the other one will be in the right ventricular apex. So the right ventricular apical catheter will give us a backup pacing, and the hispanal catheter will help us in giving a fluoroscopic landmark for the hispanal. So what we usually do is we'll do a quick mapping from the groin used with a quadripolar catheter. Just I'll try to push up and come back to delineate the extent of the hispanal. So even if you are going to do a hispanal pacing or a left bundle pacing, you need to know the extent of the hispanal. So the idea is to get the fluoroscopic landmark of the distal hispanal. So wherever hispanal pacing is being done, it's always better to go into the distal extent, because distal hispanal pacing is going to give you a better R wave, a better lead threshold, and probably a better stability as compared to proximal or mid-hispanal.
So you can show the fluoro screen.
So even if you're going to do a left bundle pacing, you need to know the distal his so that you can go probably 1 to 1.5 centimeter below the distal his signal. So you can see here in our EP system, can you switch out the EP screen? So you can see the ECGs, the main ECG leads which I want to see during the implantation is lead V1, lead V5, and lead 2. So these are three important ECG leads which I want to always see during the procedure. And of course, his bundle electrograms will be running on the screen. You can see his distal and his proximal.
You can show
and
the review
you'll be
screen.
Able to appreciate where the level of block is. So this is another important thing while performing a conduction system pacing for AV block, because you'll be able to delineate where the level of block is. You can see here block is in the AH level. So it's going to be a
both the screens
nodal AV block. So identifying the level of block will help us in going for the target in a correct way. For example, if it is a nodal AV block, then the chance of doing hispanal pacing or the chance of successful hispanal pacing is going to be very high, because your distal hispanal will be disease-free. Similarly, if it is going to be a HV block, then obviously you'll have a disease hispanal. So you have to do extensive mapping of the hispanal system to get the right spot for narrowing the QRS. Similarly, in doing a left bundle pacing, once you know that where is the distal extent of his, then that will act as a fluoroscopic landmark. Then you can go down just 1 centimeter or 1.5 centimeter below the hispanal region to get into the target zone and go into the left bundle area. So with this introduction, we start the case, and I'll show you some interesting EGMs which is going to happen while implantation. வலி இருக்கா லைட்டா தானே இருக்கு சின்ன ஊசிமா So it's going to be a left infraclavicular incision, delta pectoral incision. So I'm going to widen it. I've already taken a venous angiography to just make sure that there is no left SVC. No. William, you can show the AH and HV, sorry, AH block and HV and QRS duration.
Sir. Sujay, sir, can you show the review screen? Yeah, you can show the live as well as the things. Sir, you can make a comment.
Yeah, I can see here that AH is blocked. You can see the A wave is not followed by the H, and all the ventricular electrograms are preceded by a sharp His deflection. So it is a typical AV nodal block, and all the ventricular electrograms are preceded by H. And the HV interval is absolutely normal. It's 45, I think, 45 milliseconds. And the QRS is normal. The QRS duration was somewhere around 95. So it's an arrow QRS escape rhythm. So most probably the etiology is going to be a congenital complete heart block, probably a little delayed presentation. Obviously, we have to rule out other infiltrative cardiomyopathies like sarcoid, which is not there in this patient.
Thank you.
Creating the pocket, trying to reach the prepectoral area. All of them, anyone pain like that? Chair, more than Chowla.
அந்த லைன்ல ஒரே ஒரு எக்ஸ்டென்ஷன் லைன் போட்டுருங்க தயவு செஞ்சு நிறைய வாட்டி உள்ள போவோம் எக்ஸ்டென்ஷன் போட்டு இங்கிட்டு வச்சிருங்க எக்ஸ்டென்ஷன் போட்டு எக்ஸ்டென்ஷன் போட்டு இங்கிட்டு வச்சிருங்க
சோ ஐம் கோயிங் டு டேக் an extra thoracic left subclavian puncture ஐ டவுன் டேபிள் அப் மா முடிய போதே சரி ரைட் Penta given? Right. So we have taken two extra thoracic left subclavian venous puncture. So here there are a few important things which I want to stress. So one is it's always better to have this usual 7-French sheath in situ before putting this C315 sheath, because this will give us better maneuverability of the catheter. You can easily move this catheter clockwise and counterclockwise. And another thing, even if you want to exchange the catheter for probably a new catheter, or if you want to reshape the catheter, so that's going to give us this access, retaining of the access. That's going to give us a better chance of retaining the access. So it's always better to keep the 7-front sheath in C2 and thread the C315 sheath over this sheath. And of course, everyone is aware of this C315 sheath. This is primarily meant for doing his bundle pacing. So it has two curvatures, a proximal one, which allows us to enter into the right ventricle, you can see here, and a distal curvature, which will allow the lead to face septally. So you can see the curvature is turning towards the septum. Yeah. Okay. So this is a sheath. So you can see two curvatures. One, there is a proximal curvature for entering into the right ventricle. So this will allow us to go into the right ventricle, and a distal curvature, which allow us to face it towards the septum. So it's always better to take it with an O35 wire. Your routine coronary O35 wire will help us in getting the sheath into the right atrium. So I'll put the 7-front sheath first. Remember, there is no deflectable sheath currently available in India. So this is a non-deflectable C315. So just waiting for this deflectable sheath to be available soon. Let go. Yeah. Show me the wire. Yeah. So either you can take this C315 sheath directly into the right ventricle, or you can place it in the right atrium, which I'm going to do it, and then gradually take it into the right ventricle. So I prefer to keep it in the right atrium, and I usually remove this wire first, then the dilator, because the valve of the sheath is really slender. So what happens if you are going to pull out the dilator first and then the wire back? The tip of the wire sometimes may injure this valve, so that will produce a nasty blood field, which is going to hamper your procedural success. It's always better to take out the wire first, then take out the dilator. So now we are in the AP view. So what I'll do is I'll go to RAV view to expose the right ventricle, and then I'll take the catheter into the right ventricle. So the two maneuvers which we'll be doing is, one is clockwise and another one is counterclockwise. Clockwise will face your sheath into the cavity, so you can do this push and pull movements, and counterclockwise will face it towards the septum. So once you reach the target site, you have to give a counterclockwise star to oppose the sheath towards the septum. So you can see the lead is in the right atrium. You can focus it towards my hand. So I'm going to hold the sheath like this. I'm giving a clockwise torque. So I'm going into the right ventricle. So you can see the fluoro screen simultaneously. And once I enter into this right ventricle, I'm going to turn it clockwise, counterclockwise, so that this will face the septum. Yeah. So now I can take the lead in. So this is a 3830 lead, MRI compatible, 4.1 front size lead. Can see the helix here. It's an open helix. The helix length is 1.8 millimeter, and you can see a radio peak part or black mark here. This is the anode. The distance between the helix and the proximal or distal end of the anode is 9 millimeter. So these measurements are very important. So this helix is 1.8, and from this helix to the distal end of this anode is going to be 9 millimeter. So in an RAVO, LAVO view, if you're going to implant the lead, so these measurements you need to know. I'm going to put this. Yeah. So the idea is to take the sheath 1.5 centimeter below the His bundle area. So you can very well appreciate here, the sheath is not going up. That means that you may have to probably reshape the sheath to reach the target zone. Let me try whether I can go up without reshaping. sometimes the sheath may not reach the target zone easily. So in that case, you may have to reshape it. It may go either up or it may go down, like in this case. I think I'll reshape the sheath. So similarly, while you're pulling it back also, you have to put it clockwise so that you can come into the cavity. Then probably you can pull it out. I'm going to pull it out. Yeah, keep it in. So reshaping, so this sheath has a good memory, sheath memory. You can show it the table here. So for reshaping, you need to have the stillet in. I'm going to put the stillet here. So here the sheath was going down. It was not going to the target area. It was little down. So what I'll be doing is I'm going to increase the curvature. So it's very simple. You just have to make it as a U-shaped curvature. I'm giving additional proximal curvature, making it a parabola or U-shape. So this will retain it for probably 10 or 15 minutes. And it's your challenge to finish off the procedure before that. I'm going to increase the septal curvature also. If it's not working, then probably we may have to take one more sheet. We can overdo it because once you are going to put the wire in, there may be some loss of curvature which you have given. So I usually overdo it and then wire, please. Hold on. Pull the wire out. Yeah. So now I'm taking this, doing the same thing clockwise to go into the right ventricle. And counterclockwise to opposite towards septum. This is a little better. So what I'm trying to do is I'm just trying to float the lead. The reach is not that great. I'm just trying to float this lead and catch the area below the septum, below the Hissmann catheter, sorry. I think I have to increase the curvature still more. I'll come back to the right atrium. So probably the distal curvature is not sufficient. So you can see the curvature which I made. So it's a custom made curvature. Let's see whether it's going to work or not. I'm going to go in again. This looks better than before. Yeah, definitely better than before. Hold the other end. Yeah, so I'm taking the lead. So I'm going to expose the lead tip just out of the sheath. So it's probably in the mid septum, little below than the usual side. Let's see, we can pace and see here. Hold on. So what we usually do is either you can bifurcate at the connector level or you can connect two cables here. That's what we usually do. So Dr. Wang has described it to get a W pattern in lead V1. Yeah, connector no pace. Can you show 2 to 12 lead in the EP system? This is too low actually. Yeah, pace.
Switched on pace.
No, it's not capturing. So let me give you a good signal now. Right. Just wait for a time. So there's some resistance there. So most probably there might be some tendon or cord which might have got there. It's always better to take it out and see for structures attached there. there is some kink in the shield which is not allowing me to reach the target side. So same thing, take out the wire first, then the dilator. RAO, get in. Still, I'm not able to reach the target zone exactly, but anyway, let me see. Right, hold on. Okay. So the sheath has lost its curvature. So again, I'm going to give the curvature. High flow O2, 15 liters O2, please. Yeah. Let me try here. This is way below. This was not a good side because even V5 is negative here. I'll try to make it a complete U. Let me see whether it works or not. Okay, so this looks better. You can see the catheter is little up now as compared to the previous positions. Can you sedate the patient little? Can you set the BP once in 10 minutes? It's a little slippery here. Anyway, I'll try here. Just hold on here. Oh no, it's slipping. Okay, I think I got some good position, decent position. Anyway, let me see here. Elio vanga. Keep it at 90 degree. I'm going to change the gloves, which I always do before screwing the lead, because that's going to give you a better support in rotating the lead. So it's always better to have a dry hand and dry lead to give proper rotations. So be careful. You have to be very sterile in changing your gloves. The septal thickness, which I measured, was somewhere around 11 millimeter. Oh my God. Go to RAO again. Gone a little below. Okay, come to a level. I'm going to give turns. RAO. RAO. Okay, come to level. Looks like a good spot. Let me see whether I am able to penetrate that spot. Record the ectopix, please. Got it? Okay. So this, regarding this ectopix, I'll discuss a little bit in detail. So which is very essential to know while implanting a left bundle lead. So there is a good injury current. Still, I'm not able to get a potential. There is a small hump just before the local ventricular electrogram, which is probably a far field potential. What is the R wave here? Okay, patency. Okay, still you have not got the R wave in lead B1. So it means that you have to go still more in. What is the impedance like?
770.
Okay, that's great. Perfect. I'm going to stop pacing here and I'm going to adjust my sheet so that I'll have still more good support. Okay. So now I'll give some more rotations.
Yes, sir.
Got it. Yeah. So this is the one which we actually wanted to get. There is an injury current, but not sure I'll be getting a good for this impedance. Pace.
3.5.
Wait. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So this is not a good spot. I'm going to come back. I'm not happy with this spot. Okay. So this current spot is a perfect spot. So if I'm able to penetrate here, so that'll be the best thing to happen. Come, Elio. But definitely there is a hell of resistance here to put the lead in. So whenever you find resistance, just take out the lead and see whether you have any tissues attached at the tip. Yeah. Definitely there is some resistance in piercing. I don't know whether she has any scar in the mid myocardium. I think I'm going in slowly. Come to your level. Hold on. V5 is negative. Not happy with the ectopic. Oh no, we got a potential anyway. So that's great. So good injury current. So it's more of a positive fascicular capture. Pace, what's the R wave like? Okay. But this is not a good site. Anyway, I don't want to be here. Yeah, we got the potential and yeah, finally we got it. What is the R wave like?
40.
Yeah, please pace. So I may have to go another one turn or so. So here you can see clearly there is a good R in V5. The previous position, there was not at all a good R. So what is the impedance like? Yeah, so I'll be happy to give one more turn here. Can you stop pacing here? You're able to see a good potential, William. Can you just show the potential in your review screen? So I'm giving, okay, that's got it. Yeah. Hope the potential impedance is not going to go below. Yeah, still we have a good injury current. Oh, we have a very beautiful potential here. This is what I was expecting from the beginning. Yeah, please tell me the R wave. Yeah. Pace. Yeah. Come down. Yeah. Mm. Selective, William. Okay, intermittent capture. So the threshold is 0.9 and there is a selective, non-selective to selective capture transition. And can you pace at 8 volt and 2 volt? Show me the R, V, this thing. See it in V6. Go to 12, the other page, and see the pace at 8 volt. Yeah, increase the R wave amplitude in lead V6. Go to 12 lead. Yeah, great. Increase the amplitude in V6. I'm talking about V6 now. So anyway, it's not seen. Can you reduce it to 6 volt or so? Yeah, now you'll be able to see, William. Go to live, the 25. Yeah, now increase the R wave amplitude. See in V5 alone, V5. Somebody can sedate the patient, please. Yeah, see in V5, R wave, the LVAT in V5. Okay, great. Now put it at 2 volt. Please. He's live on 2 now. Can you update the live screen? Please, somebody sedate the patient, please. So it's the same. Okay, thank you. So stop pacing. So I'm going to check it again after withdrawing the sheath. So still the injury current is there. Don't come here, come to the other side. Yeah, still there is a beautiful potential. What is the R wave like? Okay, pace. Okay, there's a good R wave. Yeah, impedance. Okay. Pace at 2 volt. Pace at 2 volt. Okay. Okay, great. Stop pacing. Yeah. A lot of curvatures are occurring inside. We'll be able to correct it. Put a dry gauze. Wet gauze, please. RAO, please. All you have to do is just gently withdraw the lead with a counterclockwise torque. And now I'm going to give loop. Alpha loop is the biggest problem. Yeah. Can you show up little? Show up. Show up. Mera coming hai. Right. Kila vanga. Right. So still we have a beautiful potential here. RV, please. Yeah. Hmm. Hmm. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.5. Yeah, come down 1.4, 1.3, 1.2, 1.9, 0.8, 0.7. Transition is there. Yeah. Come down. Yeah. So here we can see many of the interesting phenomena which we usually see during left bundle implantation. So can you show this non-selective to selective rate? Reduce the rate. Reduce the rate gradually. Make it 60, 50, 40. Can you give fluids fast, little fast? Can you see the pulse amplitude also? Just hold on for some time. Yeah, escape has come. Stop pacing. So we got a good QR pattern in lead V1, and you can see there is a good unipolar current of injury. David, Robert, you can show the current of injury from your system. Okay, that's great. That's fantastic. I'm seeing a good current of injury. And in the EP system, can you focus the switch over to EP system? And EP system, you can see the beautiful potential just preceding the local ventricular electrograms. So all you have to do is just measure the potential to the QRS onset. So which usually will be 15 to 30 milliseconds. Can increase the sweep speed, William. Make it 200. Yeah. Little back. Still more little back. Yeah. So it's probably around 25 milliseconds. So that's a good thing. The things which you have to see here is whether you are getting a constant left ventricular activation time. So this left ventricular activation time is otherwise known as PLVAT. Will be measured in the lead V5. So we usually measure at 8 volt and 2 volt. So you have one screen in your EP system where you can have the left ventricular electrogram as well as the 12 lead ECG. Measure at 8 volt. Just measure it here. Yeah. So it is around 51. Yeah. So now we go back to 2 volt. Don't pace now. Don't pace. Increase the amplitude. Yeah. So it's roughly the same, 53 and 56. So it's nearly the same. So that's what we are aiming for. Get a short and constant peak left ventricular activation time. That means that you have captured the left bundle. You are just not simply pacing the septum. Remember, when you are pacing the left ventricular septum also, you'll be seeing this QR pattern because your activation is into the left ventricle. But that doesn't mean that there is a capture of conduction systems. It's always better to confirm the capture of cardiac conduction system. There are a few ways of confirming it. So one is demonstration of left bundle potential, which is very well seen here. And second one is demonstration of QR pattern in lead V1, which is very well seen here. And third one is get a constant peak left ventricular activation time. So that is by measuring at 8 volt and 2 volt. And another important thing is to show non-selective to selective capture transition, where you will be able to see the local ventricular electrogram changes as well as the change in QRS morphology, or even a non-selective to septal transition. So the meaning that you are capturing both septum and the left bundle. Then once the output is reduced, your left bundle capture is lost and only the septum is captured. So these changes you have to show to confirm that you have captured the left bundle. So if nothing is working, probably you can do a programmed deep septal stimulation. It's just like doing a VT induction protocol. Pace at a drive length of 500 and just start reducing your S2 from 350. We can do it here. So here the drive will be at 450 milliseconds. We're going to give a drive at 450 milliseconds. And S2 will start from 350 milliseconds. Go to the next page, show the left bundle electrogram, it's 12 lead ECG. So we are going to paste the left bundle electrogram from the EP system, a program to deep septal stimulation. So what you have to see is, so at one particular point where there will be a loss of left bundle capture, so you'll be able to see a change in QRS morphology, change in QRS amplitude, and change in R wave peaking time. So all these things can be changed, can be seen. Go ahead. So just see, probably you can follow just one lead, just see the lead V1. And so definitely the QRS has widened. So here there is a gradual transition, which is very difficult to appreciate. Here you can see the QRS has become completely widened. This is more of a septal capture rather than a bundle capture. So there are three different responses where you can see it from this programmed stimulation. One is a pure septal capture response where you'll be able to see a selective capture of left bundle at one particular point. The second one is a myocardial response where there'll be a transition from capture of bundle plus septum to septum alone. The third one is no transition, no change. So here probably we are getting the third one where there is a gradual transition and it's very difficult to appreciate. But definitely by the end, you can see a white QRS, which was very bizarre, but still having a QR morphology. That is because of septal capture. So anyway, we are pretty sure that we have captured the bundle. So I've removed the sheath. Now I'm going to remove the 7 French Pilewy sheath also. In the loop, I'm not convinced. So anyway, we have to try to adjust the loop after removing the sheath. The loop is okay in LAO. There is some, that's okay. Go to RAO. So this difficulty in reaching the left bundle area happens sometimes. It's not always. Unfortunately, it happened today. So usually it happens in probably around 5 to 10% of the cases where you just have to reshape the sheath. The reshaping, how to reshape, what I usually do is see it in RAO. And I'll see whether I'm below the target zone or above the target zone. And here I forgot to mention one thing. We have checking this unipolar impedance rather than the bipolar impedance, because checking a bipolar impedance will not tell you whether you have perforated the septum or not. It's always better to check the unipolar impedance because the lead tip matters a lot, because you are placing the lead in the deep septum. You don't want the lead to be into the LV cavity. So always better to check the unipolar impedance and don't accept an impedance of less than 500 ohms. So our target was now close to 450 to 500 ohms. If it is less than that, we never used to accept, because that indicates that your lead is just exposed outside the septum into the cavity. What's the impedance here?
Sir, one more additional thing. We are getting the potential in the programmer screen also.
Yeah, that I think probably can focus it. But see, such a sharp potential, you'll be definitely able to see in the programmer. So what's the impedance like? It's your screen is coming on live. Yeah, it's
switching on at 100, sir. Now the impedance is 510, consistently 510.
That's great. So we want an impedance of more than 500, which you are getting it now. And once you are satisfying with the unipolar parameters, generally you have to pull back the sheath and slit away the sheath. If you're not happy with the unipolar parameters, don't rely on the bipolar parameters just to compromise your results. So always be happy with your, I think you are getting a non-selective capture. Yeah.
Threshold is 0.3.
That's great.
We are getting the selective non-selective transition.
Pass record. Go back. So that's the one thing which I always wanted to show. So you always make sure that in all of our cases, almost all of our cases, we tend to get this non-selective to selective. See what happens in selective capture. If you are right on the top of the left bundle, is there, William? Is there non-selective to selective? Yeah. Hold on. Yeah. So you can clearly see here, increase amplitude, no issues, increase amplitude. Yeah. So you can see here in the screen, review screen, the first three beats, see the local ventricular electrograms, the pacing artifact and the local electrogram, you're not able to see it at a separate entity. But in the last three beats, you can see the pacing artifact is clearly followed by a gap. And then your local ventricular electrogram is coming. So this means that initially there is a non-selective capture of the septum as well as the left bundle. So your lead is on the right at the top of the left bundle. At high output, you are capturing both the septum as well as the left bundle. So once you reduce the output, this local myocardial capture will go off and you will be selectively capture the left bundle. So that will give you a gap between the pacing artifact and the local ventricular electrogram. And you will be able to see some subtle changes in QRS morphology also. I think here it's not seen, but you'll be able to see some deepening of S-wave in lead V6, which will be easy to appreciate as compared to other morphologies. But anyway, so this is very important sign to observe. This means that you are right on the top of the left bundle and there is, and there you are not like far away from the left bundle area.
R22.
Yeah, great.
Switch on. Impedance 650.
So you can see here the lead V1, there is no R wave. That means that your anode is capturing the septum now.
Threshold from 4. 3.
Yeah.
2.
Yeah.
1.
Yeah. Yeah, now we're getting an R wave now. That means that your anode has lost its capture. Now only your cathode is capturing.
0.9. 0.8. 0.7.
Yeah, yeah.
0.6. 0.5. 0.4. 0.3.
It's a good threshold. So that's the usual threshold which you usually get. And I think the anode is deep buried inside the septum. At least 14-15 millimeter of my lead is inside the septum. So I measured a septal thickness of 12 millimeter, but still I could penetrate more because many a times your lead goes obliquely rather than perpendicularly. So you imagine this as your left ventricular cavity. So many times your lead will go a little obliquely. So despite having a septal thickness of 12 to 13 millimeter, at least 14-15 millimeter of the lead will be inside the septum. There is no cutoff for doing a procedure. There is no upper limit. There is no lower limit. I've done a procedure with a 6 millimeter septum in a 4 years old kid. I've done a procedure with a 20 millimeter septum in a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. As such, there is no cutoff, but you have to adapt the procedure accordingly. If you feel that the septum is thin, go obliquely, get your as much as possible lead inside the septum. And if it is a very thick septum, go perpendicularly so that you can have only minimal part of the lead inside the septum. So that's the only thing. But if you have scar, whatever be the thickness of the septum, you'll not be able to penetrate. At that time, probably you have to accept your defect. Can you change the ECG? AVF is right up below the 3. I don't know why AVF is below the 3. AVF should be above V1. BP is good. Saturation is good. Yeah, great. Yeah, I didn't expect. Actually, I thought it could be an easy one because an young lady, 26 years, definitely there won't be any scar. But fortunately, unfortunately, there is some scar. I'm telling unfortunately because it took long time to place the lead. And fortunate thing is that that will help in holding the lead. So that is one thing I always like, to have some minimal scar, which will allow you to penetrate the lead, but the stability will be ensured because of the scar. So here, this step, you have to be very careful because this being a 4.1 franchise lead, your J-wire might tend to pull the sheath back, lead back. So you have to be very careful in removing this J-wire. Wet gauze piece, yeah. Yeah. Show up. Show up. Pull back the lead, pull back the stillet. Yeah. Yeah. Can you give some sedation for another 10-15 minutes? So this is the advantage of having a passive fixation atrial lead. If the atrium is otherwise normal, because it hardly takes 2 minutes or probably 1 minute to place the lead in the septum. Pace. Impedance, please.
750.
730, sir. Okay, come down.
4. 3. 2. 1. 0.9. 0.8. 0.7. 0.6. 0.5. 0.4. 0.3.
So anyway, the threshold is good. The R wave is good. I'm going to split away the sheet. Loop is good, William?
Yes, sir. So PVV is again 3.7 consistent.
That's great.
Minimum drop is around 3.
So programming in an AV block doesn't matter. You just have to capture it because the patient will always be dependent. So what I usually do is you have to subtract some 20 to 30 milliseconds from your usual programming AV delay. So we usually keep it between somewhere between 70 to 90, the sensed AV delay. And many times AV block patients, they'll have only sensing of P wave. William, P wave is good?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's great. So the usual sensed AV delay will be somewhere around 70 to 90. But you have to be very careful in programming the patients with left bundle branch block when you are doing it for left bundle branch block correction. So here you have to take into account that native AV nodal conduction, so which I always love to have, because that will give you the best QRS. In fact, if somebody is asking me which is the best patient to go, or in fact, which is the best QRS you will get by doing left bundle branch pacing, I'll always say this left bundle branch block patient, because once you optimize the AV interval, so you will be able to activate the right ventricle via the native AV nodal conduction, and you'll be able to activate the left ventricle from the pacing lead. So that you will get only if your native AV nodal conduction is intact. So you have to be very careful in avoiding damage to the right bundle. Otherwise, you will produce iatrogenic complete heart block. More than that, you will lose the native AV nodal fusion. So in that case, we'll optimize the AV delay in such a way that you will mask this RBBB delay and you will get a good QS pattern in lead P1. So there again, the programmed AV delay usually varies between, again, between 70 to 100. So usually our AV delay will be either 70 or 80. And battery output, if you want to get the anodal capture, like here, I think we can see the difference also. William, paste the anode and see how it's anodal capture QRS.
Yes, sir. I think you are connected with bipolar or unipolar, sir?
Bi.
Okay, sir.
So if you want to get the anodal capture, then you have to program the output at more than 2 or 2.5, depending upon the anodal capture threshold. Otherwise, you can program it at 1 or 1.5.
Sir, actually, threshold is 1.7, sir.
Which threshold?
Anodal
capture. Ah, so it's okay. So this is 1.7. So if you keep anything above 1.7, your anode will be capturing. So I just want to know the QRS duration of anodal capture. Though it's written in the literature like anodal capture, mask the RB delay, RBBB delay, I usually prefer to avoid this anodal capture. Threshold is fine, William. You can keep at 1.5 output.
Yes, sir. Keep it.
Loop perfect. Yeah. How much is the R wave? Okay. Yes, remove panirunga idha. Yes, sir. P wave. Okay. What about AVF, William? Positive, then? 2-3 AVF, all are positive, right? So this is very important to do it slowly. Otherwise, you will try to end up in a problem. You will be ending up in a problem of pulling the sheath back. Do it slowly. PG? Okay. Case panigma. Hey, wait. He's removing the sheet. Okay. I'll just check it again. Left bundle. That's fine. Pace at 1. Okay. Pace at 1, no? Great. Madhi, stop. So reduce the rate and stop. Yeah. Okay, great. So recorded potential is recorded? Yeah, great. So we got some good QRS. So I think we have made around some 3 or 4 attempts today. So there is no harm in going for 3 or 4 attempts. Though there is a chance that you may induce some myocardial injury, because we have shown it in a paper that once the attempt is more than 2, the injury of myocardium is a little bit more and you'll have a little greater increase in troponin levels. But that hardly matters. The patient will not have any symptoms, and echo is also, there will not be any wall motion abnormality. So doing a repeated attempts is not a bad idea, unless you are pretty sure that you are not going through the same zone. For example, if you have attempted at one site, and if you feel that that site is not happy, so you have to make sure that you are not going to go into the same site again. Sometimes the lead will go into that area only, or sorry, the sheath will go into that area only. You might tend to go into the same site. The problem is, one, the lead will go easily in because you already created a path. And second thing, your impedance will be little less, and there is a chance of lead dislodgement. You will not be able to see a good current of injury. So it's always important to observe the current of injury. If it is not there, then you have to be very careful whether you are really in the septum or in the cavity.